Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning indeed that we can truly sing those words that if we have faith in Jesus Christ, that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. That as we come before your throne of grace this morning, our hope rests in the fact that Christ has died for us, that Christ has shed his blood in our place to cover our sin, to cover our rebellion, to cover our rejection of you. That our hope this morning rests in the fact that we are now clothed in the righteousness of Christ. That all his right behavior, that all his right standing with you has been transferred to us. And that all of our sin has been transferred to him and nailed to the cross. We thank you, Father, that we have been given this place to stand, this place that is both firm and broad this morning. We recognize that we were sinking deep in our sin, that we were in that slimy pit, that we were in that miry clay, but that you have pulled us out, that you have rescued us and given us that place to stand that is both firm and broad. That Christ is a solid rock. We thank you, Father, as we come to you this morning, that you are the God who is unchanging. We recognize that the world around us is changing all the time. That society's norms and values and things that are acceptable are changing all the time. That what was considered acceptable 20 years ago is no longer considered acceptable today. But we thank you that you are the God who does not change. That you are the God who is not dependent on culture, but the God who stands above it. That you are the God who is from everlasting to everlasting. That you are the God who determines what is right and what is wrong. And we thank you, Father, that we can come to you this morning and call you Father. That you are our Father in heaven. We pray that as we come together now, Father, that you would feed us from your word, that it would come alive to us, that it would show us the darkness of our hearts, but that it would show us the greatness of Christ. We pray that as we join together our hearts in the praise of you, Father, that we would sing with one voice of our great God and Father, of our great Savior Christ. We pray, Father, that you would bless our meeting together and bless all that is said and done now, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you have a Bible with you, please have it open at John chapter 5. If you don't have a Bible with you, but you'd like to follow along, there should be Bibles in the seats in front of you somewhere. John chapter 5. And we're going to read from verses 1 down to 18. John chapter 5, I'm beginning to read at verse 1. This is the word of God. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool in Aramaic called Bethesda, which has five roofed colonnades. In these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had already been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, and while I am going, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, take your bed and walk." And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and walked. Now that day was the Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath, and it is not lawful for you to take up your bed." But he answered them, "The man who healed me, that man said to me, take up your bed and walk." They asked him, "Who is that man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk'?" Now the man who had been healed didn't know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn as there was a crowd in the place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you're well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this is why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, "My Father is working until now, and I am working." This was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Amen. This is the reading of God's inspired and inerrant word, and we trust that God will bless the reading of his word to our hearts. Now, boys and girls, if you want to come down to the front, I'll come down and meet you there just now. Turns out I've had it upside down the whole time that I've had it on for the past 10 weeks. There you go. Well, boys and girls, it's lovely to see you this morning. It's good to be together in church. I want us to think this morning about rules. About rules. Does anyone's house have rules? You put your hand up, Seth, you're just scratching your ear. Good man. Anyone's house have rules? Micah. You're not allowed to know your brother? That's a good rule. That's a good rule. Does he always keep that rule, Daniel, does he? No. Does he annoy you sometimes? No? Okay. Anybody else's house got any rules? Do you want me to tell you what some of the rules are in our house? Yeah? So some of the rules in our house, what are some of the rules that I can tell you happen in our house? So, one of the rules in our house is that you're not allowed to eat food anywhere other than the kitchen. Well, the dining table, whatever you want to call it, dining room. And that means that at the end of the day, you don't have as much food mess to clear up. You just have to clear up all the food mess that's in the kitchen, and that's okay. Another one of the rules in our house is there's no indoor football. No indoor football. Not allowed to play football in the house. If you want to play football, there's a big garden there. You can go and play football there. But do you want me to tell you something, boys and girls? There's some of the rules that mommy and daddy are really serious about you having to keep. Because they're rules for your safety. They're rules for keeping everything going well. You know, you might not be allowed to touch a hot pan or anything like that, because mommy and daddy want to keep you safe. They want to keep the house clean, so you're not allowed to eat any food anywhere other than the kitchen. But there are some rules that mommy and daddy aren't that fussed whether you keep them or not. So sometimes our boys play football in the house, and we just let it go because it's not worth fighting about. But you see, the religious leaders in today's story, they were really angry at Jesus because he was breaking their rules. He was doing things on the Sabbath. He was doing things on the Saturday that people said you weren't allowed to do. And they were really angry at Jesus because he wasn't doing what they wanted him to do. They thought Jesus was breaking God's law. They thought Jesus was doing wrong things. But Jesus reminded them that God was his Father. And that God, he couldn't break God's law, because he was God's son. And you see, boys and girls, the most important thing, all these religious leaders, they thought that by keeping the law, they thought that by keeping God's rules, they were making themselves right with God. They thought that they were covering their sin because they kept all of the rules. But Jesus reminds us that we can't keep the rules all the time. That all of the wrong things we do, all of the sin in our lives cuts us off from God. And the only way that we can be right with God isn't by keeping the rules, but it's by having faith in Jesus. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for Jesus. We thank you for your Son. We thank you that he is the one who has kept the rules perfectly. We thank you that through faith in him now, we can know right relationship with you. We thank you for the boys and girls. And we pray, Father, that you would continue to bless them. Continue to show them Jesus, we ask. We pray that you bless them now as they head out. Pray that you bless their time in faith connection. And may they come to know Jesus as their Savior, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, boys and girls. You can go back to your mummies and daddies. Or well, we're going to continue our worship of God now as we sing the words of the hymn, Jesus, Strong and Kind. Well, boys and girls, you're going to head out to Faith Connection now. And we'll continue our worship of God as our offering is received. Thank you. let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come this morning, we thank you for all of the good things that you've given to us. And of your own have we returned you this morning. We confess, Father, that we're prone to take these good things that you've given to us and abuse them, turn them into idols in our hearts, turn them into things that we worship and adore. And we pray, Father, that you would forgive us and cleanse us. As we come this morning, Father, we recognize that there are many within the fellowship here who are struggling at the moment. We pray for those families who are grieving. We think especially of the White family this morning, asking that you would be near to Ray. Asking, Father, that you would oversee in all of the preparations that have to be made and all of the details that have to be sorted out. We pray, Father, that you would give Ray all the grace that she needs. We pray, Father, that she might know a measure of your strength over the coming days as visitors have to be dealt with and as various things have to be done. May she know your grace from on high. Be close to her, we ask, and go before her. Remember others this morning, Father, who are struggling with illness, who are struggling with ill health, and we think especially this morning of George, Father, just asking that you would be close to him. We pray, Father, that you would strengthen him and sustain him. We pray that he might know your hand of blessing resting upon him. We pray, Father, that you continue to be with Anne and Sam as well as they look on. May you give that whole family the grace and the courage they need over these coming days. May you give George a measure of strengthening over these coming days, that he may know your presence going with him. Remember Noel, Father, continuing to ask that you would be close to him, that he might know that we are praying for him, that we are care and are concerned for him. And we pray, Father, that he might be restored to us in due time. We remember the situation in our world as we continue to see the effects of the war in the Ukraine, Father, just asking that you would bring an end to that conflict, bring an end to that bloodshed and violence. We remember the situation in America where we've heard news of another mass shooting overnight, of families grieving, of families bereaved, and ask, Father, that you would bring peace and comfort to those families that are grieving this morning. We thank you, Father, for the great and glorious gospel of Jesus Christ that we have to share and to proclaim. And we want to pray this morning, Father, for those missionaries who are connected to the PCI, who are serving you in far-off fields, perhaps feeling that sting of loneliness, perhaps feeling that sting of homesickness. May you, Father, strengthen and sustain them. May you, Father, grant them great fruit for their gospel labors. May they see many people come to know Christ as their Lord and Savior. And we pray, Father, that you would bless us as we head to 2nd Breshean on Wednesday evening. We pray, Father, that as we hear of the work in Nepal, that it might be an encouragement to us, that it might be an encouragement to the Flemings, to see folks who are so interested. May you give us faithful, believing hearts that you are the God who saves. And we pray that as we come to study your word now, Father, that you would give us soft, receptive hearts. Help us to see the truths that are there and help us to apply them to our own lives, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. But just before we consider that passage together in John chapter 5, we'll stand and sing again the words of the hymn, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
Oh,
Again, I'd encourage you to have your Bibles open at John chapter 5, or pick up one from the pew in front of you and have it open at John chapter 5, so that we can study it together, so that we can see what God's saying to us this morning together through his word. John chapter 5 and verses 1 through 18. Now, one of the things that you have to learn when you come to a new congregation is how things are done around here, what the traditions are of this congregation. The way things are done in Glenwary isn't necessarily the way that things are done in First Portadown. I offer no comment on that, other than to note that there are differences in the way that things are done. The way that things are done in Dumfries Free Church, where I was minister before that, are very different from the way that things happen here. You have to try and figure out when communion is. You have to try and figure out what happens at communion, who gives who the bread and the wine. You have to try and figure out what happens at a baptism, who prays for who. You have to figure out when GB and BB enrollment is. You have to try and figure out the traditions of the congregation. Well, you don't, but I do. But the danger with that comes whenever we think that those traditions, those things that we've always done, are set in stone, that they're immovable. That to do anything other than to have communion when we have it would be sacrosanct. To think, well, what manner of idiot would think that having communion on the fourth Sunday in January is a good idea? That's not the way things are done round here. That's not how we do things. And as we come to this confrontation between Jesus and the religious leaders this morning, that's essentially where we get to. You see, Jesus is challenging them. Jesus is challenging their traditions. Jesus is challenging the way that they've always done things, and they do not like it. Jesus is showing them the grace and the mercy of God, showing them the grace and mercy that he's come to bring, and they do not like it. He helps and heals a man who has been bedridden for 38 years. And their only response is to say, but you did it on the Sabbath. Don't you realize what you're doing? Don't you realize the rules that you're breaking? Don't you realize the traditions that you're breaking? It infuriates them because he breaks their traditions rather than, as they argue, the commands of God. We're going to see three things this morning from John chapter 5 and these 18 verses. Firstly, we're going to think about a compassionate heart. That as Jesus sees this man, as Jesus sees the struggle that he's gone through, Jesus has compassion on him. But secondly, we'll see a callous heart. You see, the religious leaders aren't interested in compassion. They're not interested in grace and mercy. Their hearts are hard because they do not know the grace of God. Their hearts are hard to this man's suffering and pain, and all they can say to Jesus is, but you've done it on the Sabbath. And then thirdly and finally, we'll see the cause for their hatred of Jesus. Not only does he break the Sabbath, not only does he not conform to their expectations, but he makes himself equal with God. And so they seek to kill him. A compassionate heart, callous hearts, and cause for hatred. So firstly then, compassionate heart. And we see that in verses 1 through 9 of John chapter 5. So last week then, when we were with Jesus in Cana of Galilee, we saw the start of his compassionate heart, really. We recorded his compassionate heart, didn't we? This ruler of the kingdom came to him and said, look, my son is ill at the point of death. And Jesus responds with compassion and says, go your way, your son will live. But after that, we're told, verse 1 here, that there was a feast of the Jews and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now think back a few weeks, we saw Jesus leave Jerusalem because he didn't want to provoke opposition. He didn't want to provoke premature rejection of him. But now we're told here, verse 1 of chapter 5, that he's returning to Jerusalem. After healing this ruler's son, he heads back to Jerusalem. There was a feast of the Jews, and so Jesus goes to the feast. We aren't told which of the feasts it is that Jesus is going to celebrate. There were three feasts a year whenever Jews were expected to go to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast. The most obvious one, of course, was Passover. And so Jesus, being a Jew, Jesus, being a good Jew, obeys the law. He goes to Jerusalem. He goes to celebrate the feast within the confines of the city. Remember, of course, that Jesus came not to abolish the law and the prophets, but to fulfill them. His point wasn't to provoke opposition to God's law. His point was to show and fulfill God's law truly. God's word told him that he had to go to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast. And so Jesus, being a Jew, went. When he gets there, we're told he goes to this pool by the sheep gate, so-called because it would have been the gate that all the sheep would have come through for the sacrifices that needed to be offered. So this place is this pool then as a busy place. It's a place where crowds would have gathered, especially at a feast time whenever there were sacrifices to be found. It's a place that would have been bustling. It's a place that would have been noisy. And he comes to this pool called Bethesda. Now the name of this pool means it's the house of mercy, house of grace. Beth is house, Seda is grace. House of grace, house of mercy. And Jesus here is about to shower grace on this man. He's about to shower mercy on this man. We're told, verse 3, that it's the place where the invalids would have come to lay, those who were lame, blind, and paralyzed. They're brought to the house of grace. They're brought to the house of mercy. They're brought to the pool of mercy. The blind, the lame, the paralyzed come and they seek mercy and grace from others. Would have been where people would have given them alms. People would have given them money to sustain themselves. People might have given them bread. They're brought to the house of mercy in the hope that someone might show mercy to them. And we're introduced then, verse 5, to this man who has been an invalid for 38 years. 38 years of begging. 38 years of being dependent on the mercy and grace of others. 38 years living off the scraps that others could give to him. 38 years of waiting for the water to be stirred up. 38 years of watching someone else get into it before him. 38 years of seeing others healed of their infirmities and him being there. Imagine the mental state that this man must have been in. But now, mercy is about to be shown to him. Now grace has come to him. And Jesus comes by, verse 6, and perceives that he's been there a long time, and he says to him, "Do you want to be healed?" No doubt moved by compassion at the man's plight. No doubt moved by compassion at how long the man has been there. He stops and asks him the question, "Do you want to be healed?" Now, that seems like a strange question, doesn't it? Because, of course, the man wants to be healed. Of course, the man doesn't want to lie there for another 38 years or however long God would spare him. Of course, he wants to be well again. Who in the same situation wouldn't take that offer? But it's perhaps not as strange as it sounds. Because then by being healed, by expressing this desire to be healed, this man would become responsible for himself. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, at the moment Jesus comes to him, he could count on the grace and mercy of others. He was sustained by the grace and mercy of others. He was sustained as people gave him an offering as they walked by. He could count on charity and compassion from those visiting Jerusalem. But once he was healed, once he was well again, that charity, that compassion would evaporate. It would be time to go out and get himself a job. It would be time to go and sustain himself. One of the great mantras of the conservative government that we currently have is getting people back to work. They set the safety net of universal credit there. Yes, of course they do. But they want to make it unappealing. They don't want people living off charity, off handouts. And so they want to make sure that work always pays more. They want to make sure that work always pays better. In a very real sense, they want you to work for yourself rather than relying on the government. And that was the choice that was set before this man here as Jesus asked him, "Do you want to be healed?" It was the choice of working for himself, of looking after himself, or the choice of continuing to beg off others. So what's the man going to say? Well, he says, verse 7, "Look, there's no one here to put me into the pool when the water's stirred up. while I'm trying to get myself in, someone else gets in before me. There's always someone in front of me. He thinks that Jesus is asking him if he wants Jesus to put him into the water. He thinks that Jesus is going to help him down into the waters the next time that they're stirred up. He's misread what it is that Jesus is offering to him. Jesus isn't going to help him into the water. Jesus has something better to offer. That living water that he offered the woman of Samaria at the well. And he simply says to the man, get up, take your bed, and walk. And immediately the man is healed. Immediately the man picks up his bed and walks. But so what? What does this mean for us this morning? How does this impact how we live today? Well, there are two things that we need to be mindful of here. Firstly, we're reminded of the compassionate heart of Jesus towards those who follow him, towards those who are suffering. What's Jesus' description of himself? How does he describe himself? That he's gentle and lowly. And that's what we see here, isn't it? It's a Savior who's gentle. It's a Savior who's kind. It's a Savior who's compassionate towards those who are suffering. And maybe this morning you feel wounded. You've been wounded by the world. You've been wounded perhaps even by experiences in church. Your heart's heavy this morning. But we're reminded here that we have a Savior who is gentle and lowly. We're reminded here that we have a Savior who is compassionate toward our suffering, who helps and heals us. But secondly, the challenge for us is the question that Jesus asked the man is exactly the same question that he asked each of us this morning. Do you want to be well? Do you want to be healed? Now we're talking here healed not in a physical sense, not from all the infirmities that we might suffer from. But Jesus asked each one of us this morning, well, do you desire to have your sin forgiven? Do you desire for your right relationship with God to be restored again? Do you desire that that gap that exists between you and a holy, righteous God to be bridged? And we have to decide for ourselves, do we want to be well? Do we want to be healed? Do we want to have our sins forgiven this morning? If the answer is yes, then Christ stands ready and willing to forgive. Come to Christ and be sure that by no means you will be cast out. Call out to him. Come and have your sin forgiven and be healed. We see the compassionate heart of Jesus, but secondly then, we see the callous hearts of the religious leaders. John records for us what the problem is in verse 9b. Now that day was the Sabbath. It's that that's going to provoke such a strong response from the religious leaders. It's that that gets them so riled up. And so the Jews come to the man who's been healed. They see him carrying his bed, and they say to him, whoa, 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 hold on a minute here, friend. Don't you know it's the Sabbath? Don't you know you can't carry your bed on the Sabbath? Don't you know that you're not allowed to carry this burden? Now, the problem for us comes whenever we try to work out what the Jews are saying here. Where in the law of God is bed carrying on the Sabbath forbidden? Oh, we could turn perhaps this morning to Jeremiah 17. That forbids burden carrying on the Sabbath. The problem is that Jeremiah 17 is clearly based around trade. It's clearly based around carrying items for sale, for trade. The prohibition there isn't so much carrying the item itself, but it's carrying it to sell to the marketplace. I have no proof of this, but I strongly suspect that the man here in John chapter 5 isn't carrying his bed so that he can go and sell it somewhere. He wasn't breaking the commandment of God, but he was breaking their tradition. He wasn't going against what God said in his word, but he was going against what they said in their interpretation of God's word. You see, the Jews had created all these traditions. They created all these commandments, extra commandments around the Sabbath in order to try and get people to keep it better. They determined how far you could walk on a Sabbath before it became work. What you were allowed or not allowed to carry on the Sabbath. And it's that tradition that this man has broken here. Not the law of God. Not the commandment of God. What we need to remember about the Sabbath, friends, is that it's given for our good and for our benefit. It's given for us by God, for our good and for our flourishing as humans. You see, we can turn the Sabbath into something really quite dull and boring. We can turn the Sabbath, just as the religious leaders here do, into a rules of things that we're allowed to do and things that we're not allowed to do, but that's not the point. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Sabbath was given to us for our good and for our flourishing as humanity. We should enjoy our Christian Sabbath rest. The opportunity to draw aside from our regular worldly cares and concerns. The opportunity to come and to worship God. The Sabbath has been given to us for our flourishing. But what is the man going to say? So the religious leaders have said to him, look, you can't do that. You can't do this on the Sabbath. But he answers them, verse 11, the man who healed me, that man said to me, take up your bed and walk. And he says, look, I'm not getting into this with you. All I know is that this man who healed me, this man who made me strong, he said, take up your bed and walk. If you want, you can take it up with him. He's the one who's got all the power here. Whenever I worked in Sainsbury's, I was the checkout team leader in Hollywood Exchange. Now, that basically meant that if somebody was angry, they came to you and you had to kind of try and deal with it. But one of the things that somebody would often say to you if you hadn't resolved their query quite to their satisfaction, they would say, is your manager here? They want to talk to someone with more power. They want to talk to someone with more authority than you have as the mere team leader. They want to see the boss. And that's essentially what happens here, isn't it? The man says, look, whoa, whoa, whoa. Nothing to do with me. I'm just following orders. I'm just doing what I told. The man who healed me, he said, take it up with him. But they clearly aren't happy. They want the main culprit caught. They want this man brought before them. And they say, well, who is it then? Who told you to break the law? Who told you to pick up your bed and walk? But the man doesn't know. Can't find him. I don't know who he is. There's a huge crowd there. There's loads of people pressing around. He doesn't know who Jesus is, and Jesus has withdrawn into the crowd. But he finds the man again, verse 14. And he says to him, see, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you. Now, these words can be difficult to interpret, can't they? Because on one level, we can read them and we can say, well, the clear implication of what Jesus says here to the man is that his infirmity has been caused by sin. It is that his paralysis has been caused by some sort of sin in his former life. Therefore, Jesus says to him, look, sin no more, that nothing worse, nothing more than this is going to happen to you. But that's not where Jesus is getting at. It's not what Jesus is getting to, I don't think. Rather, there's something worse that Jesus is referring to here is hell. It's eternal separation from God. The eternal judgment that's to come. And Christ says to the man, look, sin no more so that you don't suffer that. Sin no more so that you're not eternally separated from God. Sin no more so that you're not cut off forever. But in all these interactions with the man, what is it that's missing? From the religious leaders, what's the one thing that they do not show? Compassion, isn't it? Here's a man who's been bedbound for 38 years, and rather than say, wow, isn't this great? Isn't this such a display of the power of God? They say, no, it happened on the Sabbath. There's no joy that he's been healed, no rejoicing that this man can now support himself. Just an annoyance that all of this has happened on the Sabbath. All of this breaking their rules and regulations. How dare he? And sometimes it's easy for us to fall into the same trap, isn't it? To have that lack of care and compassion and concern for others. To have that lack of empathy for others. You know, somebody finds themselves in a difficult situation, we say, well, brought it on themselves, didn't they? It's their own fault. We can be annoyed when our rules and our regulations are broken, when the things that we think make a good Christian are not followed, rather than God's law being broken. The call to follow Jesus this morning is a call to show the same care, the same compassion that he did. To show the same love for those who are struggling as he did. The religious leaders show no compassion, no care, no concern. But Jesus does. Their callous hearts are exposed by Christ's compassionate heart. Thirdly, finally, then, we see their cause for hatred. And we see that in verses 16 through 18, their cause for hatred. So we see verse 16, what their first problem is. And this is why John tells us the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. He was breaking the law that they had made. Now, it's important to say at this point that in their minds, they had a valid reason. They had a valid method behind it, if you like. You see, their teaching stressed that the day the Sabbath was observed perfectly by all the Jews, then the Messiah would come. So by doing these works on the Sabbath, they think that Christ is inhibiting the Messiah from coming. They're inhibiting the Savior from coming. And so in their minds, by trying to stop Christ from doing these works, they're ushering in the kingdom of God. They're ushering in the Messiah coming. That's why they hate Jesus initially. That's why they're against him initially, because they think that he's stopping the Messiah from coming. But Jesus cranks up the tension in verse 17, because he says to them, look, my Father is working until now, and I am working. My Father's working. This isn't a time for rest. My Father, who's Lord of the Sabbath, is working. This isn't a time for rest. My Father, who's the initiator of the Sabbath, is working, and therefore I must work. So verse 18, they sought all the more to kill him. The whole Sabbath thing was bad enough. Not keeping their rules and regulations was bad enough. But calling God as Father, making himself equal with God. We've moved in their minds here from differing theological traditions into downright blasphemy. And so he must die. They hated Jesus because he broke their commandments, because he broke their rules about what it meant to be a good Jew, what it meant to be a follower of God. But I wonder, friends, what is it this morning in your mind that makes a good follower of God? You see, we'd be tempted to say there's lots of things that make a good follower of God. You might be tempted to say, well, reading your Bible every day makes you a good follower of God. You might be tempted to say, well, being at church every Sunday makes you a good follower of God. Putting money into the offering plate week by week makes you a good follower of God. Trying to live a good life makes you a good follower of God. Trying not to do anyone any harm makes you a good follower of God, but it doesn't. It doesn't. Any of those things on their own this morning, friends, are not enough to make you a follower of God. That's following the rules and regulations that the religious leaders lay down here. What makes you a good follower of God today is that you have living, personal, saving faith in Christ, the Son of God who gave himself for us. All of those other things may flow from that. Coming to church, reading your Bible, being a good person flow from following Christ. but they don't make us a good follower of God in and of themselves. The religious leaders this morning were dependent on their following the rules, on keeping the laws. But what are you dependent on? Dependent on keeping the rules, following the laws? Are you dependent on Christ, our compassionate Savior, the one who is gentle and lowly? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for Christ. We thank you that he is indeed gentle and lowly. We thank you that he is a compassionate Savior. We thank you that he saves all those who truly call to him. May we this morning now be found not trusting in our own righteousness, not trusting in our own good works, but may we be found trusting and looking to Christ, this compassionate Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. We're going to bring our time of worship of God to a close this morning as we stand again and join our hearts together using the words of the hymn, "My heart is filled with thankfulness." Oh, sorry, Martin. Talk amongst yourselves. Let's stand together and join our hearts together in the praise of God. My heart is filled with thankfulness to him who bore my pain. Thank you. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us all, both now and evermore. Amen.